All right, it's an ME262 at Riyadh, the Royal International Air Tattoo, and we're going to be jumping inside. But first of all, let's make a walk around. So up front on the aircraft, we have, of course, a gun camera in the nose that is linked to the actual trigger of the pilot when he unleashes his four MK108s that are just behind there in the centerline position. Now, these guns aren't the best ones for air-to-air combat in many ways. First of all, their rate of fire, 650 rounds a minute. Then, second thing, we of course have a muscle velocity of roughly 500 meters a second. So this is like shooting a mortar in air-to-air combat. The shell goes out and it drops down. ...360 rounds combined with all four guns. And we have the Minengeschoss. Now the 30 by 98mm RB shell that this gun used was a specially designed high explosive shell. And it contains 70 to 85 grams of high explosive, depending on which exact Minengeschoss you would be using. And that is packing a wallop. Now, generally speaking, in World War II, planes would be limited to about 20mm cannons, which would be fitted with HE fillers of around about 2 to 10 grams. The Germans pushed it up to 18 grams as well on their Minengeschoss, the 20mm round. So this really causes some absolute damage there. We also have the front wheel. In the ME262, that was introduced in the fourth prototype. Initially, it was a tail dragger. So they fixed it up as a tricycle landing gear, and that would swing inwards just below the guns. Behind the guns, you also have a fuel tank, the main fuel tank, 900 liters there, the first one of two, and an auxiliary fuel tank, 170 liters, just below the cockpit. And of course, there's oxygen bottles stored there as well, next to the fuel tanks for the pilots at high altitude. Inboard slat here, I'm going to talk about those in just a second, but let's come to the engines. Junkers Jumo 004 engines producing a thrust of round about 2,000 pounds. This allowed the aircraft to go around about 900 kilometers an hour in a straight line. The engines that we have right here are not the Jumo ones. These are General Electric CJ616 engines, but they are built into a nacelle that is reminiscent exactly of how the ME262 would be looking during the Second World War. And of course, this is a flying example here at Riyadh, which is really, really special. Big, big thank you here, of course, to the Messerschmitt Foundation and also Airbus for making this possible. The original engines would also have a Riedel Anlasser, or a Riedel starter motor, which was a two-stroke engine in the front, and that would just allow the aircraft's engines to come up to the RPMs it requires for an easy start of the engine. But now, as we come towards the wings, just a quick note here on, of course, the engines and the airframe. 400 ME262 roughly made operational service during the Second World War. However, we have 1,500, roughly 400, 1,400 to 1,500 completed airframes and 6,000 engines. So what happened? Well, a lot of the engines weren't really useful. They were built with bad quality and bad quality control because Germany, of course, abused a lot of forced labor during that time. There's other videos that I've already done to talk more about this. The placement below the wings, however, very good for changing your engines very quickly. That could be done in roughly 30 minutes in operational conditions, which for World War II standards is blistering fast. Slats, of course, here, they pop out at low air speeds, increase the wing surface, and that provides more docile stalling characteristics. Coming then to the wingtip, of course, we have navigational lighting, and then we have the aileron. It is an active air show, by the way, if you're wondering why there's noise. Yes, that is a Gripen flying right now. Flaps, and the engine outtake. A second main fuel tank here, 900 liters. An auxiliary additional fuel tank could be mounted as well with 600 liters. We have a Mutter compass, and we have the radio set in here as well. Initially, you're seeing right here, of course, modern radio antennas. What you would have here in the Second World War is the RDF antenna. It's a loop antenna for radio directional finding. Coming then to the tail, very conventional tail setup. However, note, of course, the rudder and the elevator trim tabs as well. And then we come around. But flare dispensers here, those are signaling flares, by the way. So green, red, or yellow, white. And that would be used for air-to-air and air-to-ground communication without using the radio. The pilot, of course, would mount on this side. You see the Einstiegsklappen, so the little handholds and the footrests for him to get inside. And the canopy would swing outwards. The aircraft itself, the fuselage, is semi-monoc. That means there are longerons running alongside the fuselage. You have frames and then stringers between those and stress trim just above that. Coming then to the other side of the wing, let's talk about the weaponry, pitot tube of course, but let's then talk about the weaponry. We would have wooden mock-ups right here for R4M rockets. Those are 55 millimeter rockets used for air-to-air engagements. They're dumbfire, so you don't definitely do not have any guidance. And they were meant to be used for to be fired off en masse against Allied bombers. And of course, if we come inside, there was also the centerline position, which would generally be able to house about 250 kilo or 500 kilogram bombs. And those could, of course, be fitted in a Yabo configuration, fighter bomber configuration. Now, remember, of course, that the order for all fighters that Germany puts into production going forward was in early 1943 that bombs had to be carried. So the Messerschmitt company and Luftwaffe itself knew that any fighter that was going to come forward into operational service had to carry bombs. So provisions were made by the company fairly early on to make that happen. And of course, yes, the decision to use these aircraft as fighter bombers was a decision that also delayed their general introduction as a fighter aircraft, but it did not delay the process all that much, as is sometimes said. Now, with that being said and done, let's jump inside.
Although this is a flying example which requires some concessions to the equipment and cockpit instruments for modern flying regulations, the ME262's cockpit we have here is remarkably similar to the original layout we saw in a previous ME262 Inside the Cockpit episode. On the whole, the jet's cockpit features a fantastically clean setup. So let's get into it. Big thank you here at this point to all patrons and channel members, and especially supporter Andy C for sponsoring this episode. Inside the Cockpit is 100% community funded, and without your support it would not exist. If you love this content, check out my Patreon and channel membership page to support future content and earn some unique rewards while you're at it. Now, inside the cockpit we will start as always on the left, with me taking you around the instruments in a clockwise direction. On the far left we have the yaw trim. Moving forward from this, I believe these are the fuel cock or fuel pump switches, and then we have the throttles. The push buttons on the throttles would originally be used for the engine starter unit. The inner red handle was originally for the valve manifold of the engines. The larger handle with the red grip was for the pitch trim. Moving forward, push buttons for the flaps and gear. A flap deflection indicator and a gear position indicator round off this area. To the front left now, this panel has changed substantially from the original layout. Now what we have here is an emergency hydraulic reservoir release switch and a compass. Moving then to the front instrument board, we can see that the gun sight has been removed and instead we have a G accelerometer and a clock. Below this, your basic six in the original position, although some of these dials are more modern than the World War II spec ones. You can see your altimeter, a gyro artificial horizon, and a speedometer in knots in the top row. Below this, from the left, a vertical speed indicator, a heading compass, and the turn and slip indicator. And then to the bottom left, a temperature gauge and, where the weapons console would have been originally, a modern radio set. Moving then towards the right, the engine control dials in their original layout. Up top we have the engine RPMs, and below this the individual oil pressure and engine temperature gauges. And then in the third row we have oil temperature gauges in the middle, as well as an ammeter to the left and a fuel consumption indicator to the right. Fuel flow and individual fuel tank indicators are in the bottom row. Moving to the right, we have a red handle, that is your canopy emergency jettison, and we have a large circuit breaker panel. Behind this, further to the right, the engine starter switches, the emergency gear release, and the connection and electric plugs for ANR headsets and USB. Finally, coming to the flight stick. The original safety and trigger switch has changed somewhat because, well, they're not really used here. The weapon cocking switch is also missing. Instead, we have a new addition, which is a trim switch. I'm not sure what it is linked to, but it could be the aileron trim. I also assume that the small switch next to it is your radio push to transmit. And this rounds us off inside the cockpit. And if you thought that was remarkably fast, yes it was. The ME262's cockpit is quite a clean setup, and this modern iteration is even more simpler than the World War II spec one. Again, a big thank you to all channel supporters for making this content possible, and all you viewers for your interest in this series. We wouldn't be filming this ME262 without you. Big thank you to the ME262 pilot, Gary, for his gracious welcome and for agreeing to an interview which I will post in the future. Gary will talk a lot about his experiences in flying the ME262, so have a look out for that. As always, channel supporters will have early access. An additional thank you goes to the Messerschmitt Foundation and Airbus Defense and Space for liaising with us for the filming. As always, all you legends have a great day and see you in the sky.
So to show you how to dismount an ME262 in the official way, it's the famous slide. Woohoo!